Suzy and Kris. I just want to welcome them this morning and say what a pleasure it's been to work with them the last few months in preparation for this. And I want you to notice now, at the level of preparation, at the level of delivery of this conference, we are partnering. We're not just librarians doing this on our own, but here are our colleagues in the Department of Ed that represent yet different areas, those areas that you'll be working with in a similar way. So we're right on time, and so I'm just delighted that we are. I'm going to hand the microphone off, and I hope you'll tell people a little bit about yourselves.
Thank you, Myra. Well, good morning, almost afternoon. I'm Kris Shaw, and I work at KSDE with Jackie. Let's see, a little bit about myself. I am the Language Arts and Literacy Consultant. We changed that name when Kansas College and Career Standards came along, because before I used to be the Reading Consultant. So now I'm kind of over everything having to do with literacy and the English Language College and Career Ready Standards. My background is elementary. I taught second grade. I was a reading, remember when reading the title one was chapter one? That's when I taught. So I taught second grade for 16 years, reading specialist, a little tiny district, St. George, which is now Rock Creek, and then went on to Walmego. And then my librarian that I had in my with my second graders was Joni Dobrowski. Does anybody know Joni? Okay, yeah, and she just retired this year. So she and her para, Linda Krebs, both retired at the same time. So I have no idea what those people in Omega were doing, because she was my librarian that I counted on for all my resources that I brought into the classroom, the extra resources that I needed for my teaching. And we're gonna do in just a little bit something about that. But Suzy, do you wanna introduce yourself?
My name is Suzy Oertel. I'm actually in the process of changing my name, so I also answer to Suzy Myers. I got married, and then I'm going back to my old name, which is really strange and confusing for most people, but that's what's happening. So right now I'm in a period of hyphenation, and then once I actually legally change my name, then I'll drop the Oertel from it, and it will just be Myers. But my teaching experience is high school language arts. I was also the yearbook advisor. I'm trying to put it out of my mind, so I was also the yearbook advisor at a small school. I started my teaching experience at Washburn Earl High School in Topeka, so I have that large high school experience, and then I moved to Atchison, Kansas, and I was teaching in Effingham for several years before joining the State Department just last July. So my certification that I'm working on right now is actually a national board certification for adolescent and young adult English language arts. And I'm so excited to be here with you today. It's my first time at the working with a group, big group of librarians. So I'm happy to be a part of this. Thank you.
Okay, so we're gonna start on a journey today, because we've been on a journey for the last, 3 years, 4 years since college and career ready standards have come into our lives. So let me figure this keyboard out. No.
There it goes.
Okay. So part of our journey was thinking about, so what have we been doing and what's new for us? And some of the things that we've been doing have come back around. When I was teaching, I started in the 80s and then the 90s. And then all of a sudden this big bad boogeyman came along, the assessment. And then things started changing. And actually that's when I started at the State Department, where I went, we started having a yearly assessment. Now I'm looking back at what we were doing in the 80s and the 90s, and I'm thinking, oh, wait a minute, this college and career ready stuff, the Common Core kind of stuff, it's about the same stuff I was doing back then. This is just coming back around, it seems like. But there are some differences. So this journey that we're going to take you on today is kind of what's coming back around, but what are the things that are different that I didn't know about, really? Text complexity, that was new to me. And then when we started digging into it, well, okay, it's not so new, but it's a different idea of what we used to have from before. So that's what we're gonna do. We're going, this first day of the conference, we're gonna go back and go on our little journey of where we're heading, and we're going to end up with learning resource sets at the end, and we have a big poster that we're going to give you about our learning resource set that you have to bring back tomorrow because you only get one copy of it. So we'll give you that at the end of the session, and then you'll bring that back with you tomorrow, and we'll talk more about what learning resource sets are. My voice is very deep today. I didn't notice. Myra, I think she left, our Wonder Woman. I love to hear her talk because it's always some like epiphany of, oh my gosh, that's so intellectual. And she brings up some things that I think, oh my goodness. But when I look at this question or this reflection idea, please reflect on what you will be able to observe, see here, when you have successfully implemented Kansas ELA College and Career Ready State Standards in your schools and districts. What teacher practices will be different? What student work? What instructional materials? And Myra, when we were talking about this, she brought up the idea of primary sources, and that they're not readily available, and we don't see them a lot as teachers, but that's kind of where the where we look for complex text. And that's really the complex text that kids are faced with now when we're thinking about where do we get the rigor? How do we apply more rigor? And you have a great resource here at Emporia State University. Her name is Ashley Todd Diaz. She's one of the librarians here. And then she here? Hi. There's Ashley. So she recommended, Ashley is somebody who would know a lot about primary sources. So I'm going to, and I did want to mention, this day, this hour that we have today, I'm going to be asking and calling on you to do a lot of discussion together, kind of shoulder partners discussion, working with some of the materials in your packet. So we're going to have a lot of fun, and you're going to be doing stuff during this whole time. Feel free to go get snacks, come back, but we're not going to just be lecturing. We're going to have you doing a lot of hands-on things. So this is our first shoulder partner activity. So with the person beside you, I'd like you to talk about what you observe as having successfully moved to college and career ready standards. So I'll give you some time to talk about that.
Thank you.
ideas about what our schools would look like.
Who would like to share?
I don't know if this counts or not, but this past year is the first time that I have pulled nonfiction sources from my kindergarten and first grade teachers and had their students do a research paper about an animal. And I thought that was really cool.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know if they had a little graphic organizer thing or how they did it, but they came down and they picked out their animal and I found the books. And so I thought that was kind of cool that we're starting that now, and I think that's something that they will build on as they get older.
Especially at kindergarten. That is cool. Yeah. Who else would like to share what you're talking about?
Is that we see kids actively engaged. We just don't give them a textbook, read these pages, and do this quiz. It's like, what do you want to know about? And they're on the internet, and they're finding books and resources, and they're calling people or Skyping with people across the world. And so kids are actually proving what they know and being the leaders in the classroom for their own learning, with our wonderful guides, of course. And as you know where they end up, they didn't have us around. So I think that we talked about just even teachers are communicating more, collaborating more, and thinking about how are we going to understand these standards and how can we work collaboratively to communicate to the kids what they need to let know and our parents and what have you.
Sometimes we don't have major projects going on or whatever, but one thing I like to do is to take something that I noticed or got interested in the process of hearing about the curriculum the kids are studying and also seeing things in my library, and I make good ideas all the time, and just modeling that inquiry process for my own learning and showing the kids that. And
sure.
This is what I learned from this. And this is why this now means a lot more to me.
Right, that inquiry process of, digging deeper into knowledge. Anyone else like to share?
I think what we talked about here was that I can see us going back to like when I was in the classroom 27 years ago. I got to focus on what my interests were as long as I taught the skills that the students needed to learn. And I can see the Common Core being the kind of a thing where I can focus on something I'm really interested in as long as I make sure those standards are being covered. And I think a lot of the teachers are going to really enjoy that, not have to focus so much on the content.
Wonderful. So I think we're going to see some things stay the same, but we're going to see more rigor applied. I don't mean making things so hard that kids can't do it, but more rigorous so that we're upping the ante. And we're doing that for all kids. We're letting all kids be exposed to hard text, not just a select group and then dumbing down the text for some others. We're letting all the kids see that rigorous text and grappling with it. And also we're paying attention a little bit more to the staircase of complexity. So I start off at the beginning of the year with a little bit easier, and then I'm thinking about all the way through how to up the ante. So by the end of the grade levels, I'm at almost to that next grade's, or I am at that next grade's readability and qualitative and quantitative levels. Okay, so now we're going to look in your packets, and there is a copy of the Gettysburg Address in your packet. Years ago, Steve Del Vecchio was our keynote speaker. He was one of the writers of the Common Corps. And he helped writing with Appendix B of the Common Core. He helped pull together the exemplar text at each grade level. And he, when he was speaking, he emphasized that that list of texts, first of all, he could get copyright rights to share that list. So some of the ones, the texts that he picked that did not make the list were because of copyright issues. So pure and simple copyright. Another thing was he was looking at the staircase of complexity and where those fell with Lexile levels or whatever readability level he was using. And then he was looking at the qualitative pieces of the text. And he talked a lot about the qualitative pieces of the text. And we've learned a lot about the qualitative pieces of the text. And especially in Kansas, I think, and because of Jackie's good work, and she pointed out that we have all this information about qualitative text, but how in the heck are we going to be able to actually figure it out? There weren't any pieces that we could figure out what the qualitative pieces, how to read qualitative information in the text. So Kansas is well known across the nation for coming up with the rubrics, the reader and task considerations, those kind of process pieces that teachers can actually use hands-on, to figure out qualitative parts of the text. Quantitative is easy, you just run a computer program. And that's, the computer tells you what the quantitative levels are, but qualitative is a little bit harder to do.
Okay,
Gettysburg Address. We are going to, pull up my notes. This piece of text is pretty complex, would you agree? Okay, very complex. It's typically used at eighth grade. I had to ask our social studies guy, when is this used? Eighth grade, social studies, when they're studying American history, Civil War, Abraham Lincoln, one of his famous speeches. So we're going to start off with doing, having you do an analysis of this text. You're going to do kind of a, not a free primer, but go back to text complexity, and you're going to use one of your rubrics, 101. Okay, we're going to go back to text complexity 101. You have two rubrics in your packets, one's informational and one's literary. And Suzy and I actually had a discussion about which rubric are we going to use, because if this is a literary piece, it's beautifully written, it's beautiful, but it's also informational because it's a speech and it's a primary source. So we ended up, we settled on informational, and we also thought the rubric that you use depends on the purpose of your teaching. So anyway, we ended up with informational rubric is the one we're gonna use. We're gonna have you do analysis right now because it's a pretty short speech, and that was one of its the beauty of it is it was so short. So we're gonna have you read Gettysburg Address and then look at the rubric and do your own qualitative analysis of the rubric. I'm going to tell you right now that this piece is 1350 Lexile, which is high school level. So it's 1350. So I'm going to let you loose on the informational rubric, and you can do this in partners with partners, because the discussion of the rubric and the informational pieces is the power of doing this this analysis. Okay, go ahead and apply the rubric to Gettysburg Address.
Opportunity to now insert yourself into some of those conversations that are happening in your workplaces already. We wanted to get some of your feedback about not necessarily where you put it or what you chose, but just the process, your experience of the process of doing this. Complexity group.
So the features are the sidebars, bulleted lists,
questions, the additional things of the
they're not in this text.
Okay.
Yeah.
And no graphics.
No graphics.
That's because it's so literary.
Right. Oh, that's a good. Can you talk about that some more?
Well, I was just gonna say that you can't really look at text features or graphics. It's not because it's short pieces, but because it is literary in a way that's informational. So it's almost like you have to have a different rubric that sort of takes the best mode, then it fits mode.
And that was.
So it's a little harder, you have to kind of go back and forth and almost think about how they're saying it.
But I've seen this piece in a textbook with lots of text features. You know, explaining what exactly Lincoln was doing, where he's getting where located, all the maps, you know, if it's in a textbook, used as informational text, it would have a lot of text features. I've also used it in English class where there might be a whole different sort or maybe no text features. You use text sense if you're using English class.
Right, right. So it kind of goes back to what's the purpose? So why am I teaching this? Am I teaching it as a literary piece or an informational piece? So, yeah. But the conversation, that's the part of it. So the processing. Anyone else dig something up from this speech?
Unless you knew that Lincoln was standing on a battlefield, you don't know what his purpose is if you don't understand the archaic language. And so looking at this purpose is what was the purpose of the text in the first place? Not so much how am I using it, but what was it written for?
Okay. You might be aware that there was talk about, I'm not sure among the Kansas group, but nationally, about doing a bunch of placemats and then publishing them for people. But the group in Kansas wisely, I think very wisely, said it's really not about what comes out on the other end. It's about these conversations that you're having and talking through what really makes this text complex. So does anyone want to share where you placed the Gettysburg Address, or what you found in your analysis? Okay.
I don't feel like I'm a pro at this, but I put the purposes and the text structure as more on the slightly complex end, but the language and the knowledge demands is very complex. Even though actually what Lincoln did was he said, well, this is, you know, in the past, this is, you know, why we're even gathered here. Right now we're fighting a battle to defend those values. And then he calls the American public to, as a future, as a vision for the future, dedicate ourselves just like the soldiers did. But, you know, the language is complex, but yet if you really, really read it, it makes a lot of sense. But it's complex, like, thus far so nobly advanced, you know. But then when you think about, oh, he needs those soldiers, what they did when they died on the battlefield, and they were dedicated to this unfinished work, and now we need to be dedicated to this unfinished work. So the ideals are there, but it's complexly stated.
Thank you.
Okay, these are links, and you, Myra has posted this PowerPoint online. So in the PowerPoint are links to the Text Complexity website at KSBE, and then also the Text Complexity website that we in Kansas work with a national group, and they took our text complexity idea and then built a website around that. So you have two places where you can get all of pretty much the same information.
Can we go back and look just a little bit at another perspective? I guess my question is, that when you're evaluating sixth grade writing, you need to be within one to be in compliance.
Uh-huh.
So I'm not in compliance with my friend here.
Okay.
At all.
Okay. Do you feel like
not at all, but especially with the purpose.
Okay.
do you feel like if you had more time to discuss and kind of hash out why you're so far apart, that maybe you could come to maybe not a consensus, but more of a, this is why I placed it here and this is why she placed it over here. Because we're finding that people do that. I mean, there are widespread ideas that are separate, but they have a reasoning behind why those things are in separate places. But after they have enough discussion about it, they either keep it where it is or they do move closer together or one way or the other.
Okay, then I guess my question is, when you're the one or two ELA teachers or history teachers or whatever sitting out in Cogdonville, Kansas, how important is it that you agree or don't agree? Or, I mean, how much time are you going to give on everything to have that purposeful discussion? I understand that, but it's time to teach the kids.
Right. And I don't think you would have that purposeful discussion about every piece of text that you're going to give, put in front of a kid. But if this was my seminal, my anchor text, this was the one that I was going to do the bulk of my teaching with, I would want to have that discussion. But I'm not going to have it about every single piece of text. I don't. These ladies actually have used it more in the classroom. Do you have something you guys want to add about that?
I just feel better using another analysis in addition to the quantitative. And it doesn't matter to me if I agree on every single point with my colleagues quantitatively. But I do like to have a good discussion with my fellow literature teachers in my middle school a couple of times a year on some anchor texts, but I don't feel bad if you don't give it a lot of time. But it just makes you feel better to not rely entirely on quantitative, well, for me anyway.
There are some videos on the CCSSO website of teachers, and it's actually Julie Aiken's having them go through the process of a qualitative rubric. So that's available on that website. You could drag it out forever, but I think the process of going through the discussion and having, especially those big seminal texts, the ones that are going to be really, really important, just the discussion with the teachers and the teachers being able to pull out, so this is going to be the important part of what my instruction is going to be about. It's obviously important between my colleague and I. We're having this huge, big, long discussion. I better pull that out as an instructional piece. Yeah, and that's exactly Julie's saying. It helps clarify why am I doing this instruction, because that part of the text is either really difficult, important. There's something about that part of the text that needs to be taught.
Right. Or ed staff.
On the other hand. Where'd she go? I think what's interesting about, especially the informational text, maybe our differences of putting a purpose that's very complex or more on the slightly complex, is the background knowledge that we bring to it as well, I think, and I think is why we vary so much. And so I think that's just an important step for, you know, the knowledge demands and talking to students about the background knowledge, because a lot of us can understand, you know, in our discussion we put it as the slightly complex for purpose because we're like, oh yeah, we understand what's going on already. Kind of, we had that background knowledge, so I don't know that.
Well, and I'll say something from the committee real fast about that. As you are filling out that chart that you're doing, you're supposed to be looking at it as a reader, not as a teacher or the background. So if you're filling that out as a reader of that, think of it as a reader. If you were a fifth grade reader, how would that look to you rather than as an adult teaching that unit, you already having the background knowledge. Remember, we talked about that a couple of years ago when you were here, when we were first introducing it, that when you're filling that part out, the part that you fill out as a teacher is the backside, the activities and consideration. That part you fill out as a teacher, but when you're looking at how complex it is, you think of it as just as a reader, not as an instructor.
But isn't this a way to gauge how much schema you need to help your kids build? It's a way for teachers to look at it and say, okay, I need to let them know a little bit about the purpose, but somewhere they're not going to know that a score is 20 years. So we need to, you know, it's just, the way I look at it is it's a way for you as a teacher to know how much background you need to build with your kids before they can take this on as their own.
That's a distinction. What I was wondering is, you're talking about fifth grade writers, or is it part of what we're supposed to be teaching them to do is to defend their opinion? And they may have a different opinion from mine, but if they can defend it, we've done something. Am I correct in that part of what we're doing? Is
draw evidence from the text,
right?
Yes. To defend what they're...
And we don't sacrifice facts, but for example, what happened in a battlefield when people died? How does that hallow the ground? What does he mean it's hallowed now? And just to have them to think about that and make a point and begin their point.
Right. Yeah, and that's a good segue for the next little piece that we're going to. So you can see the power of this process, that you being a part of the process and not just being told, here's where this falls on the rubric, that now you're into the process of figuring out what is the power of the text. Okay, we're going to go through the next couple slides pretty quickly. This one is the new revised text complexity grade bands according to quantitative levels. This chart's available through many sources, but this is using the computerized readability scales, and then just laying it out in the grade level bands. So that's on the PowerPoint if you'd like to look at that. Okay, the informational text rubric's the one that we just used to find the qualitative measures, and there's also a literary rubric for literary pieces. Okay, we were going to show a video. It's about 7 minutes, and it's just teachers talking about this idea of looking at the text for a purpose, not just looking at text and saying, oh, yep, I always teach that, I'm going to teach that now again. But this is really reflecting on pieces of text, and why am I teaching these particular pieces of text? And we're going to skip the video, but there's a link to it if you'd like to watch that later. The key learnings that came out of this group were the text complexity and close reading and academic vocabulary and then syntax. Okay, we are going to dwell on this a little bit. Text-dependent questions. This was another thing that came out of the College and Career Ready standards that we thought, hadn't heard of that one before. But what are text-dependent questions? They can only be answered with evidence from the text, can be literal, and that was kind of an argument point or something. That people were saying, well, the questions are going to be too simple then, if they're always literal. But they can be literal, but must also involve analysis, synthesis, and evaluation. So they're not just questions like, what color was the wagon that the little boy was dragging down the street? Well, it was a red wagon. It would have to be a little bit deeper level, higher on Bloom's, or whatever scale you're using, but
literal questions come right from the text. Focus on word, sentence, and paragraph, as well as larger ideas, themes, or events. Focus on difficult portions of the text in order to enhance reading proficiency. You can also include prompts for writing and discussion questions. So that's kind of the definition of a text-dependent question. Okay. And then text-dependent questions are questions about theme, vocabulary, syntax, and structure. So they fall in the three categories. Do those look familiar in any way when you're thinking about the College and Career Ready standards? They're actually just standards, right? They're pieces right out of the standards. Here's some non-examples and examples. In case you have the bat, Casey strikes out, describe a time when you failed at something. Is that text dependent or no? Okay, they're just drawing on their prior knowledge. They don't even have to read Casey at the bat. They can just talk about some time they failed. But here's one that is text dependent. What makes Casey's experiences at bat humorous? So why is it funny that he actually fails? Okay, and then there's some examples of more. The one at the bottom, in the Gettysburg Address, Lincoln says the nation is dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. Why is equality an important value to promote? Do I even have to read Gettysburg Address? Why is equality an important value to promote? No, I can just make up something. But then this one is text dependent. The Gettysburg Address mentions the year 1776. According to Lincoln's speech, why is this year significant to the events described in the speech? Why did he start off with 47 years ago? A kind of a reminder. Okay, now it's your turn. Which of these questions are text dependent? I'll give you a little time to read the questions, and then yes or no, are they or are they not?
Gettysburg Address.
This is all in relation to the Gettysburg Address. Yeah.
Number three. That the use of now, which is, I mean, that's a pretty common word, but I think it's used a lot of times in there. Number four. Right, right. So you have to draw them back to the text and really make them look at the text. Close reading. The word too can be, I mean, you can get yourself dug into a hole if you spent well on just the word without the text. Can see? You can. No, that's a good point. Knowing your kids, that helps with that. Multiple meanings. number five.
Yes.
And then the last one, number six. Could be both. And it kind of depends on your purpose. Am I teaching social studies or am I teaching the speech? And how far along do I want to go? How much information do these kids need? Okay. Okay, we're gonna kind of speed through this little part too. There is a document that a lot of schools are using. I had it. There it is. It's called the toolkit. And it, when you print it out, it turns out being this pretty thick little document. It's called the Toolkit for Evaluating Alignment of Instructional and Assessment Materials to the Common Core State Standards. And really, it's just a compilation from a lot of different sources of rubrics that schools are using to choose instructional materials. There's one in particular for, it's called the IMAT, that we know a lot of schools are using to choose their textbooks, their basals, their anthologies, those kind of things. But how many of you have heard of the publisher's criteria? Okay, there's a couple of documents. They're called the publisher's criteria, and they're for elementary and then high school. And they were written to tell publishers, this is what we need to see if you're going to be aligned to the Common Core standards. So this is what we need to see in a textbook or a basal or an anthology if you're going to say that you're actually aligned. And it was written to publishers. But now a lot of people are looking at it as support to help them know what to look for in a textbook. So the IMAP took the publisher's criteria and the standards and kind of put them all together and made a rubric out of it. So if you're looking for something to help teachers pick instructional materials, that's a good source. And the link is right here. It's on achievethecore.org. And if you download the whole thing and print it off, it ends up being
kills a tree.
But I know a lot of times people will come to the library and ask those kind of questions. And there's a list of the different materials in the toolkit. Okay, now we've come to the idea of we're kind of transitioning into standards. This Venn diagram came out of the English Language Proficiency Standards. And it's on Stanford University's website. The idea was that if I'm teaching English Language Proficiency, ELL kids, I'm not just teaching one subject, I'm teaching everything. So the diagram has math, science, English language arts, and then where they converge.
And so in the center are English language arts, math, and science, and then all the pieces together. So it's a nice diagram to show how the standards fit together, and that most of them do fit together. You can't really teach English language arts in isolation of the content areas. And this is kind of one of my things. People would say, I can't teach science and social studies anymore because I have to teach reading. I say, well, what are your kids reading then? What are they reading about? How can you teach reading if you're not reading about anything? So that diagram kind of brings all of the standards together and shows people how overlapping they are. Okay, the Student Achievement Partners and the Council of Great City Schools have projects going on right now, and they're grant projects. So they are free projects. They're free to everybody. They have three big projects going on. One is spatial alignment project, anthology alignment project, and the read aloud project. And what they're doing is they're bringing groups of teachers, librarians, together from big school districts like LA, Las Vegas, Atlanta. And those school districts are bringing things they already have. They're bringing their basals, their anthologies, their textbooks out of their libraries. And they're building college and career ready lessons from those basals, anthologies, and textbooks. And then, next slide. Okay, so I already went through that. And the read aloud. Then they're putting those lesson plans on Edmodo. So if you go to Edmodo, and then put in, you have to have a code on Edmodo to get into the folders. So the codes for those free lesson plans are already out there. The basal alignment one is pretty cool because they took the stories, and then if a story didn't have enough meat in it, teachers were saying, I've been teaching this story forever, and I can't find anything in it to teach. It's just a cute little story. So I don't know if on this website they say that, but some of the stories are not included because they just don't have enough meat to teach. And then there are a lot of other basal stories that have text-dependent questions, that have ideas to bring in writing, listening and speaking, and language aspects. Okay, so now we've come to what we came here for. our next sets. We've been working with Student Achievement Partners and the Council of Great City Schools to help them design these lesson plans. We're vetting them for them. But even when we go to their meetings, we kept saying, but you're not teaching teachers the process. How are they going to come up with a lesson plan that's college and career ready if they don't know how to do it? If you just keep giving them these lesson plans, how are they going to know how to create their own? So we brought together our committee of people that we use quite often. We said, you guys, if you were creating this lesson plan, how would you do it? What would the process be? How are you doing it? Well, of course, they came up with these lesson plans that they kept giving us. We kept saying, no, we don't want your lesson plans. It took us like three meetings before we finally said, we don't want the lesson plan. We want, how do you do it? How are you figuring out this great lesson you keep giving me? So this was kind of our processing through how are you guys figuring out a college and career ready lesson to show us. So we're gonna pass out that big chart. We came up with a game board because the process to us seemed kind of like a step-by-step game that we're going one step, two steps, three steps, uh-oh, you did something wrong, go back a couple steps.
and then redo that, okay, one step, two steps, three steps, and at the end you came out the winner, but you always went back to the game after you got done with it, and you played it again, and now, oh, I know more than I did before, so now I can play the game better, so now I'm going through the back through the process again. Suzy's passing out the game board. We'll kind of, tomorrow we're going to go, we're going to break the game board into pieces and talk about it more, but we wanted to give you an idea of what we were talking about today. Does anybody have any questions about what we've been talking about all along? Or any ahas or... read the text and pretty much process it on their own. This is for all kids.
Okay, so my next question then also is, can we order these from the Department of Ed?
Wow, we could make some money on this deal. Okay, this is what our plan is. This is a pilot for us right now. So we brought it to the librarians because we knew we could get a lot of good feedback. We want you to say, this part works, this part doesn't. This part needs to be refined, nobody knows what you're talking about. This part right here, like this little square, needs more support for teachers. This part needs to go away, this part needs to keep. That kind of stuff. We need feedback. We're going to pilot this all summer. We're also going to take it to our summer academies and pilot with teachers that come to the summer academies. And then somehow, through a survey, through something, we're going to get your feedback so we know what to fix.
Yes. Also, in addition to what you see on the page, we're right now brainstorming, because imagine this being interactive and educators being able to go in and click on each of the squares and then support materials being able to come up. So we could use some feedback also from this group about what kinds of support materials would be best to be behind each of those squares that would really help educators navigate this process.
So what we're thinking is that you would take a piece like Gettysburg Address, and that would be your anchor or your seminal. This is it. I'm teaching this. You do your qualitative, quantitative analysis. But then you would pair that with pieces to scaffold, things that would help bring that text to life. That's why we call them learning resource sets and not text sets. Because we're thinking art, music, video, anything that you could pair with that. But we don't want everything in the world. We just want what helps that text. Okay, so that's part of the process as well. And we'll talk about this more tomorrow.
I'm sorry to keep you because I know we're done, but also, Kris, I started to mention this, but the other reason why we're calling them learning resource sets is to appeal to people other than language arts teachers or those who would start with the text. This was a conversation that kept coming up, and we had our consultants from science and social studies with us in the room, and they said, if you call it text sets, that will be a turnoff to a lot of content area teachers. And so what I love about this graphic is that all of these new standards that Kansas is adopting are really built with a mind for collaboration among educators. And so we wanted to build a process that would be accessible to all educators, not only language arts educators. So you as school librarians who work with all educators can be thinking of it from that perspective as well.
Perfect. This is a good place to
be. Yes.
Perfect. Perfect. I hope everyone will take a break. There's more food out and drinks. And be back exactly on time because we'll have our first drawing and we'll start with our first author right at 11:05. Let's see presents to win.
Just to remind you, I'm Kris Shaw from Kansas State Department of Ed, and Suzy Oertel is with me as well. I'm going to get the PowerPoint up here. Yesterday, I talked about a video. A video that showed teachers talking and processing through what Common Core meant to them, and trying to figure out kind of the crux of Common Core and the power behind it. And Myra told me as I was saying, well, we'll just skip that today and you can watch that on your own later. She heard this. So I'm going to show that video first. And it's one of my very favorite videos of teachers discussing Common Core and, there we are. It's one of my very favorite videos. And where did YouTube there? Oh, it's up there. Okay. This is Warshoe County, which is in Nevada. And we've actually worked with these teachers a little bit on a project with Student Achievement Partners.
Well, I was looking for something that was going to help me with Common Core because I could not wrap my head around how to create lessons in my lesson planning with Common Core standards.
My impression of a text-dependent question before I came to the test project was, so what time did Little Bear go outside? That, which is a good, great way to start, but it's so surface compared to what we're really asking them to do now.
We don't want to spend a week on this and move to this and move to this. And then it provided a solution to that. I came to the Core Task Project. The first close reading exemplar we were given was the Richard Feynman text. And I had some reservations about it, but my kids did incredibly well with it. I found that it really leveled the playing field in the classroom to have students attend to text.
But I had looked at the exemplars. This is way too hard.
The one that we had the most success with was the New Colossus, and the first two questions I thought were going to kill us. And it was just trying to figure out that rhythm of the lesson and how, where do you support and where do you not support. But by the time we got to the third question, the kids were so engaged.
The New Colossus by Emma Lazarus, and I
thought to myself, I don't know many adults that can read this successfully, or who are going to be interested, because it comes across, especially when you start those first two lines that are engaging in this idea about a Greek statue, and oh, how boring. You know?
Those students came to hear uninterrupted what a beautiful piece of writing sounds like. You know, I was glad to get the permission to do that.
It's a death sentence. And as I looked into the lesson plan and it said they're going to analyze the writing scheme for the poem, I was thinking, why? This fifth grade? Isn't it possible that this might be a lofty goal for this text? And I again experienced extreme nervousness and anxiety. And again, I was becoming aware that the anxiety was a lot more about what I believed. I was facing a real paradigm shift. You know, really big one. Because I believe what everybody believes. I don't mean to believe it, but it gets into you. This idea that certain learners are less capable of engaging with certain content. And when you add this negative affect that I thought would come with this particular poem and the idea of a rhyme scheme, I just sort of, I didn't panic, but I experienced extreme skepticism. And humbled, I think, is the word that I keep using about what these kids can do if we get ourselves out of the way. And I think that we've been making a lot of mistakes based in compassion for our students that have gotten us into these negative, these de-skilling almost patterns in our instruction. So we've been taught that, you know, these students have background knowledge deficits, vocabulary deficits. So we make this great effort to smooth the road for them. And unless they want to navigate the bumps, we're not teaching them to be thinkers or readers.
It was in second grade. And so we read, you know, we read and reread and reread that text and ask and ask and ask and ask. And children who couldn't have read that text on their own, had one kid who's really low, but he could answer the questions. So he's forming the structures in his brain how to comprehend text when he finally can read that grade level text. And I believe that by the time he leaves Tolls, he will be on grade level. When he finally can read that on his own independently, he will already know how to think about it.
It was exciting because we had such different levels of success with the reading, where my high kids were just kind of like, just what do you want me to do? Just tell me what you want me to do. And our ELL kids and our special ed kids were the ones who were working really hard and struggling, but they could find the answer. They couldn't get as deep as we wanted them to get with it, but they were feeling very successful because they were finding the answers in the text.
It's a civil rights issue to withhold instruction from students because we feel that they can't do it.
And then what we saw is that they can.
The kids have to think in a different way, but we have to think in a different way too.
And this project allows the teacher to sit back and watch the students open their brains up.
And I think for me, I'm going to be going on that journey with the students as they show me how deeply they can really think, because I don't really know, because I haven't been teaching that deeply for a long time. And I'm excited, but it's a slow and rich process, and it's like, to me, it's like organic farming. You know, you're gonna get out there and you're gonna pull every weed and you're gonna do it by hand. It's gonna take a long time, you're gonna take off the bugs. But what you're gonna get is gonna be something that's, you're not gonna get as many melons, but they're gonna be really nutritious and they're gonna be really flavorful. It's not, you know. So that's what it reminds me of. It really is in a different way, an organic process arising from the students thinking and not from us pushing it in. So that's what it means to me.
I think that that's something that these close reading, if a teacher can let go of the need to control what's happening in their classroom for an hour and just see what happens, then they're going to find that we've been underselling our kids at all levels for a really long time.
It's on YouTube, and the link is in the PowerPoint.
It's on the website.
That's one of my favorite videos to show kind of the switch in thinking from going toward more complex text, going to more of the student doing the close reading and not the teacher, pulling in primary sources and giving the kids more credit that they can actually dig into something like that and think on their own. So I hope you like that. Okay. Are there any reactions to that video?
Nancy, do you feel like we as school librarians have a series of those kind of books, whatever, at our fingertips?
Yes. Wonderful. Yeah, and primary sources, and know where they are, and know what the teachers are doing in the classroom too. I don't know, I'm not high school, so what was the poem?
New Colossus.
It's
on the side of the statue.
See? Okay, so wouldn't it be nice to have an image of the statue or something to pair with that? So that's building a learning resource that now I'm embarrassed. Whatever. Okay. Alrighty, so let's start. I'm going to the end of this.
Hi, Kris. Kris, you might point out that both of your presentations are in the same file. So website, it says that day one and day two.
Day one and day two are together. That helps me from losing things. Okay, yesterday we kind of threw this out to you, this learning resource set map. We just kind of said, and here it is, da 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 da, and then we were done. So today, the goal for today is to go through each piece of this learning resource set and think about, in your mind, those essential questions that that Myra just went over. She had two essential questions, and they were about, and I don't have them right in front of me, but they were about how do librarians and teachers work together to build rich instructional pieces, and then how do I, as a librarian, help do that, okay? So those two essential questions as we're going through the resource sets. And we're gonna go one piece at a time. But first we're gonna look at a piece of text, and you have that in your packet. It is Spider and the Fly. And there is a new book, The Spider and the Fly. It's not new, but the poem is very old. But this is a new illustrated book. The Spider and the Fly is also one of the lesson plans in the Read Aloud project. So if you had time to go to Edmodo and log in to the Read Aloud project, there is a lesson for this particular book in the Read Aloud project folder. It's in the training materials. So this is a poem that they use as training in that particular project. But they're just using the one piece of text. Today we're gonna think about building around this piece of text. Okay, so the first thing I'm gonna have you do is with the shoulder partner, take this poem and you're going to role play. You're going to do a little role play. One of you is going to be the spider, and one of you is going to be the fly, and you're going to read back and forth. I think it's the first three stanzas have dialogue, and then the last three are just the poem. So you'll divide into this. One of you will be the spider, one of you will be the fly, and you'll read back and forth. Oh, and don't trust the quotation marks. When I cut and pasted this from a website, they got all screwy. So the quotation marks are screwed up.
Thank you.
Isn't that a fun poem?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, they're already building a resource then. Okay, so I'm a first grade teacher, and this is a poem that I'm coming to you. I put my role play hat on now. I'm a first grade teacher, and I actually taught second grade. And I'm coming to you as the librarian, and I'm checking out this book because I'm going to use this in my classroom. What connections, as a librarian, could you make with this particular poem? Yes?
So I'm going to pull some science books.
Science.
And I'm going to pull some other poetry books.
More poems.
And I'm going to pull, in science, I would not only pull spider books and fly books, but I might even pull some habitat. It's not habitat, that's what I'm trying to say, but other books that might show webs and, corners of barns and then Charlotte's Web, I guess we could, you know, pull something like that.
Right, yeah.
Maybe if we had a model of a spider or a fly, get some magazines. My big backyard has those, you know, giant.
Oh, yeah, the eyeballs again.
This probably might do some stuff with quotations or, you know, can I get into the language arts or the.
Uh-huh. Dialogue, back and forth, back and forth.
I would also get a video or just a little clip on a spider bringing something into their web to show what.
Uh-huh.
We looked at the scholarless awards, and she looked up the author, and Lewis Carroll used something, a parody of this, in Alice in Wonderland.
So wow.
Sure.
I'm just thinking of
Deception.
Oh, Deception.
Could you repeat what they're saying because we don't
know? Oh, I'm sorry. Deception. She said I would maybe pull in some books on how people deceive you. And then there's also the science idea and habitats and webs and
a video
and then the language, that particular language, and I guess there's a parody of this particular, a spider in the world.
The lobster quadrille in Alice in Wonderland is a parody.
Okay, and that even ups it to a different grade level. You could bring that in. Dialogue with something that someone said, that back and forth, especially at first grade.
I thought a little bit about peer pressure, how you know, that people can make it look good to you. It's kind of like deception too.
Okay.
How they can pull you in and then it doesn't turn out so well.
Yeah, peer pressure, flattery, pulling you in to doing the wrong thing.
Right.
Kind of along that line, the old fashioned, like in the silent movies where you have a plastic gun, drug and a black mustache.
Oh, yeah. The villain.
That villain victim.
Yeah, villain victim. And that brings it up a level too, I think.
I think you want to do a little vocabulary with them, like parlor.
Right. So the vocabulary and the archaic language. Yeah. Spelling, the syntax in some places is backwards. They flip the syntax to make it rhyme.
I would do something with science to compare spiders and insects.
Okay.
They often think spiders are insects.
With science to compare spiders and insects.
That's a great.
Oops. Okay, so here's our next generation science standards. This is first grade, because I'm a first grade teacher and I picked this book. All of those things that you said are great. I mean, that's exactly, you're right on. That's even that lesson plan that was in the Read Aloud project, picked on those particular things, and the lesson at the end of the story, the dialogue back and forth. She had little puppets that she was using, so like the puppet idea and all of those things. Well, it's almost as if you had read that lesson plan with this one particular book. Now we're kind of going that next step further, and I just went to my local library and picked up the only book they had on spiders. And I thought, you only have one primary book on spiders? But there's, yeah, they're probably all checked out. Yeah. So now, as we're thinking about these sets, we're thinking about all those pairing of things that we can put together.
You could use this to introduce persuasive text.
Persuasive text. Yeah, it is very persuasive. Yeah. Especially at first grade, too. Yeah, yeah, that idea. Yeah. Right, an art kind of concept, symmetry, the spiraling math concepts with the web. Oh, you guys are, I didn't even think about that.
Angles, webs.
Angles, how the webs are, angles of the web. Right, constant integration, all these ideas coming together.
And the diary of a spider, who's the spider in the blog.
Oh yeah, Diary of a Spider. I don't know that one, but yeah. Somebody said Charlotte's Web too. For the older ones. So that might bump this whole thing up to maybe third grade, fourth grade. Morals and fables. There's a moral at the end of the story, and there's some figurative language at the end of the story too. Something about eyes and ears and heart.
Okay, so here's my question.
Okay.
I have an English teacher that comes to me and says, this is what I want, okay? We sat here and said how every other teacher could be involved with this, okay? What I don't understand, or I cannot envision at my school, is how can this be integrated if our teachers don't have time to sit down and jointly plan a unit? See, this looks like a unit to me, okay? But the ELA teacher cannot be responsible for this. Only the math teacher isn't going to come to me because they don't. I mean, you know, that's just, they don't. So for this to work, aren't we going to kind of have to develop some units? That's where I get so confused with Common Core, because I can give all this, I can do this, but I don't see it all melded together.
Okay, that's ideas.
Well, I know about it. Yesterday said if I teach, you know, I have classes coming to me, I don't have time to teach you, so they have their plan, I just do it online. You know, I do a lesson and I pull in apples and, you know.
You build for you by yourself, right. And then you make that available to the teachers.
Not necessarily, the teachers are doing their own
thing. Oh, I see.
You know, sometimes,
and your classes.
You know, I mean, if I know you're studying continents, you know, mm-hmm.
Yeah, she's, okay, she's saying that she just does it in her own classroom or in her own library. She builds an integrated unit and does that when she has the opportunity with the children.
But you want to be the runner?
I'll run.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, she's going to run. Yeah, we've got a great discussion going because this is the crux of the problem.
I can see this happening more at maybe the elementary school that I'm at, because we can meet one-on-one at certain times of the day. My time is flexible. I'll go to them and plan and say, hey, how about, what are you teaching? Let me help you plan some resources. At the junior high school, it's the same problem as Mona here. Now, our administration is positive in the fact that they do let each section, like the ELA section, the math section, meet for collaboration for about an hour every 9 weeks. Well, they're trying, but unless someone takes the lead and says, okay, I'm going to do spiders. Let's make this between cross. Let me meet with some math teachers. Let me meet with some science teachers. Let me meet with this. It's not going to happen.
That this summer, we have summer academies, and that is one of the topics that, we're talking about with our administrators. How do you have an integrated curriculum at middle school and high school?
I'm in the elementary library at my school, and I ask the teachers, what are you working on in the classroom? And I do the same thing. I pull books, I do lessons with them in the classroom, videos, whatever I can do to supplement what they're doing, because that helps them take some of it off of them too, so they're, you know, and I have some different things that they don't know that I have or that they aren't familiar with. So I try to do that with my teachers all the time.
Wonderful.
And elementary is easier.
At my son's middle school, I think it's all up to the administration, because my son's middle school has 900 students in it, and they have team time. But their team is made up of science, math, language arts. Instead of doing all the language arts teachers together, they have one from each thing. And they meet once a week. And so that would be an ideal time. You know, but following up, I'm elementary, and I would find out what the classroom was doing, and then I would do the math, science, da-da-da-da-da in the library, if possible. Or every once in a while, we would be able to get together. I mean, even at lunchtime when we're all eating, I would throw out the idea, or we got to where we had certain themes throughout the year and just built on them every year. And we just all wanted to.
So, right. And I love that. We all wanted to. If we all went to the administrator and said, hey, we all want to do this.
And the one teacher that didn't want to, the peer pressure was too hard.
This is just piggybacking off kind of what Jan said. Our district has a very tight pacing schedule for the curriculum. And when I was doing some of my observations, one of our librarians showed me, here's where you find the pacing guide, and then you can see what is coming up. Mm-hmm. And I wasn't able to do that this year, but that's part of my plan for this coming year, is to follow what are they going to be doing and how can I make what I'm doing fit with that, even if I don't have the time to collaborate.
Right.
I've found
what they're doing. Yeah, curriculum maps, pacing guides, those kind of things give you a clue. There's a couple more.
And as I'm moving, I'll just share, as a high school teacher, I had a wonderful library media specialist at my disposal. She was awesome. And you all, librarians, are in a unique position in that you are sort of the center of this wheel of all of these things happening. So often I would go to her and say, here's what I'm planning, here's what I'm doing. And she would say, you know, Mr. So-and-so is working on this other thing, maybe, and you share some students. That was the other thing. In a large school, we didn't necessarily share students, but some of those collaborative opportunities were brought to me by my library media specialist because she knew everything that was happening in the school. So just throw that out.
Well, I have just two thoughts. It always surprises me, and I'm not really saying that somebody isn't doing things well enough, but it always surprises me that there's a
I mean, it's got to come from the administration, right, too, and the leadership, but it always surprises me that that doesn't happen. I mean, surely that their talk was best practices, too.
Right.
Well, I know that sounds maybe a little simplistic, but it puzzles me.
It puzzles me, too, but I love that if we all want to do
yeah,
it.
Yeah, that's probably what we have to do. And another thing, too, since most of us have schedules where we have to do things kind of quickly or on the spot, I think another thing so that we don't get overwhelmed, I think there's validity in taking the themes or the big ideas from their units in the various core subjects, and sometimes you have to just make a good choice or a realistic choice, one that you think you can communicate well. And I mean, otherwise, we want to coordinate, but I mean, it could get to be overwhelming too. And frankly, sometimes they don't have time to tell us, well, I'm doing this. Sometimes they say, well, I don't know, I'll have to check, and I feel like I'm putting them on the spot.
Right. One more, and then I think we need to move on, because I think.
This is not okay, no, end on probably, but I'm still a classroom teacher, and my librarian doesn't ask for anything. So I, every week when I'm getting ready for my lessons, I send her a suggestion for a book to read to the kids that will correlate with that. And she does sometimes, and she doesn't other times, but I figure that's the least I can do to help get her.
I think we have a problem, but I don't think it's insurmountable. And I also think that administrators are kind of waking up to the fact that, yes, we need a more integrated curriculum, especially with the College and Career Ready standards, and Next Generation standards, and the new Social Studies standards. I think there's more of an idea of, let's not pull the curriculum to pieces, let's do some more integration. And actually, that's a topic this summer for our summer academies, so it is kind of coming from top down a little bit, too. So we're hoping that if we all want to do it, why don't we all kind of empower ourselves to say that we all want to do it.
She did some stuff with integrated thematic instruction. And she had a book for elementary school, and she had a book for high school. And maybe that's something that could be looked for. Like I said, it's old stuff. But as you said yesterday, we've just come around the circle again.
Uh-huh.
And so maybe some of that stuff would be worthwhile to look up again.
Right.
It was funny when we were planning for the Summer Academy and around this idea, because all of the standards are being kind of built this way with collaborative experiences in mind, and a lot of the research that we were looking at was from the 70s, 80s, 90s, you know. Well, that's not wrong, you know. Okay, so now we're going to dive into the learning resource sets, and we're going to kind of piece this apart, and we're going to give you an opportunity to look at yourselves, the librarian role, and go from step to step to steps, and they're color-coded. So right now we're at the green step, and we gave you the example of spider and the fly, and you guys came up with lots and lots of things that could be connected. So in your mind, you can keep that spider and the fly topic, or you can think about something that when you go back home, maybe you're working on something at home. So the spider and fly could be one, or you could use your own. But we're going to look at the green section first. And I'd like, if you work better this way, to share with your shoulder partner, what would you do with this first green section, the first chunk of this game board? And you can use your essential question, too. I think that will tie if you're taking this course. Aren't the essential questions part of the course, Myra?
Yeah.
So if you're taking the course,
you can use those essential questions and kind of do your work now. Another way that you might think about this, especially if you're coming at it from a high school angle, if an educator comes to you and says, this is what I'm doing, whether that be an English teacher, science teacher, social studies teacher, remember that this process is still in draft form and we're looking for feedback. So you could think about it as, what is the school library media specialist's role in this green section? What do the conversations look like between you and educators who are coming to you for help in this phase of the unit building process?
And then when we're done, we're going to ask for feedback from you. So what would you do with this green section?
Of this process. I believe that the first process is a teacher purview, and somehow the step identify resources is not in this snake. And we are the identify resources part. And we're not anywhere on here. We get to gathering resources, but you never identify them. And somehow down here in the resource sets, nowhere does it say library media specialist.
Okay.
So I think we're missing a step right here in between green and blue of identifying resources. And that's where we come in. I think we come in after the goals. Because the teachers have a goal that is their curriculum goal. And we will facilitate that.
Okay. So.
Thank you. Good feedback.
Yes.
We have people down there taking it.
We also put our email up if that makes you more comfortable to send us.
Well, I think that's true, but you can start before then. We have a day when I'm provided with a substitute all day, and all I do is meet with the classroom teachers. Unfortunately, it doesn't happen often enough. Right now, we're just doing it once each semester. But we kind of go through the semester and look at, this is what we're planning to do in social studies. So this is a real rough outline. At that point, they don't have all of their learning targets and all of their standards. Lots of times they start with the standards before they have learning targets, or they have their final projects all lined out. But it's a good time for us to throw our ideas in. And I'll say, well, have you thought about, and lots of times they're just like, no, that's, you know. This is a day when it's not just the librarian in our school, but the art and the music and the PE teacher. We all sit in a room with each grade level. And, you know, when you're not used to sitting all day, it is really long. But it does help us. It's a start. It's before you get to those. And so it lets us kind of see what's coming up long range. And I wish we had more time like that, but it's a good place to start.
Right. Okay.
And perhaps we should choose one teacher to start. You know, I can name in my middle school and high school, you have teachers who are pretty resistant to someone else suggesting things for their class. Then you have teachers who would love to ask. Start with one of them and say, look, these are things perhaps we could use, or you could use with my help, or I would love to help you, however you phrase it, to where this is what I learned at Summer Institute. Let's put some of this to work in your classes, see if we can help you.
Right, so it's kind of a continuum of maybe one-on-one all the way down to our whole school is an integrated school.
I'm a high school English teacher right now, and I was just thinking, even with the spider and the fly, like the crucible, that would be the main, the kind of the mentor anchor text, and that would be what the teacher would say, okay, we're doing that in our curriculum right now. And then they could go to the group of them, or one of them could go to the librarian and say, what are some goals, some ideas that we can bring in with deception and peer pressure, and even, you know, even more historical of the Salem witch trials. I think that's the English teacher's role as well, so, you know, talk about that, the building the context as well, and then having that process go forward. And then, so I do think the librarian can come in right here at the beginning, maybe the teacher says, this is the text, the main text I'm doing, what are some ideas that you have, some goals, some other essential questions that we could do with that.
Did anyone think about if a science teacher, for example, would come in and ask you for some help with this beginning piece? Maybe they aren't necessarily beginning with a text like the crucible or something like that. Any discussion about that?
I was thinking of what Myra does with the science teachers at Emporia State, and she showed a science poetry activity with the shape poetry, and that's probably where I would start.
Thank you.
Hi. I just want to emphasize that I really believe the librarian has to be involved at the very beginning of the first step, because ASL has published for us a really nice set of information standards, and if you're not there with the classroom teacher when they're looking at their language arts or their science standards, that's how you pull your research and your information standards and dovetail it right in there and help them see it. That's where you get the real synergy of the library teacher coordination or collaboration.
Jackie was just talking about the library standards this morning, so in saying that
I was just thinking about, too, this is sort of related to something that the author was saying yesterday, that as a former English teacher teaching To Kill a Mockingbird, I mean, you heard just how many possible directions you could go with a simple poem like The Spider and the Fly. Think of how many possible directions you could go with a big novel at the high school level. So you, as a library media specialist, can really help the teacher think about the learning goals and what might be available, what might be most engaging for students, because you can teach that book a million different ways. So you can really, I think, be involved in helping sort of guide the classroom teacher.
They said I didn't have to stand, but you know, we've been working on another project a lot with success criteria, and they say for that you write I can statements. Mm-hmm. You know, as the student will say, I can understand what a web, you know, what a web looks like, or how a web is designed by a spider or whatever. And I think when you think about those goals, if you not only have in your mind what the instructor wants and you want, but also how's that going to equate to the student? So for example, The Spider and the Fly might be a hook that you would read to get them involved in the idea of a web, but really you're going to look at it in mathematical or scientific terms. But that's how your I can statement, I think, would help clarify exactly what you want to have done.
Okay, we're going to move on to the next step, step two, gather resources, which we've already talked about a little bit, but I will give you some time to think about that, and then we'll talk about that step two of gathering resources. Right, Barb's reminding us of the definition that we're using art, visual, digital, observation, those kind of things, not just text.
Written this down in establishing purpose, but it isn't gathering resources.
you know, don't gather 10 books if all the teacher's looking for was a book to read that half hour, you know, from 3 to 3:30 or something for the sub to read. So make sure you know what they're wanting. If they want a unit developed, you can do it. But don't do it if they don't want it, you know.
Right. Too much is sometimes too much.
Clarify a little.
Are we looking at this as support for the teachers, or are we looking at it as ourselves as instructors? Because as I'm looking, I'm seeing different perspectives.
I think we're looking both as, I would look at it as myself, librarian, because that's where your role is. But you can also think about the role of the teacher as you're doing that. I would think of it as myself.
Okay. I'm going to shout out, and I'm going to ask Mara to contribute to this. So we did a survey a few years ago where we asked what role you were playing in your school. And did you have your own standards that you taught, or were you collaborating? And most of you came back and said that you were collaborating. And over the years, to me, this has been a catch-22, because sometimes when your student's collaborating, they forget the role you play. But if you're doing instruction and you have your standards, then that sets you apart. And I think you have to figure out a way to carve, well, you're seen as dispensable.
No, I mean, integrate your standards with
theirs. Yeah. And when you do that, sometimes, I mean, it didn't. Well, but I'm saying if that doesn't work for you, fall back and use your standards. We're going to have our new ones. You have those from AASL. And let people know you have your standards, and they're just as important as everybody else's. Because I will tell you all the discussions I have.
I would argue that as a teacher and a librarian, because I've been on both sides of the fence, that when I collaborate with my librarian, who's sitting right here, she has become indispensable. Like that. I mean, that fast. Within a year of collaborating with her, I didn't want to leave that building ever again because I could not do without her collaboration.
And I'm going to turn around and argue.
So, okay. I mean,
I'm gonna argue
I think
this
you
point.
Have to be, but she's also very good at integrating those library standards, which I wasn't at the time.
And
so.
my argument is, and this goes back to advocacy that we had a few years ago, if you go to your administrator and you share how invaluable it is, that's good. But the administrator is not the one who sees it at times. And therein we get into a huge problem, because you can be doing just fine as a school librarian, you have a different administrator in. They think that they're not indispensable, and there you go. All of a sudden, you're doing a planning period. All of a sudden, well, let's replace you with a clerk. And the reason I say that is this is ideal. But I get a phone call from administrators. I mean, one year I went to the annual conference, and an administrator received an award for being an outstanding administrator. I went back to my office that Friday afternoon, and on my desk, I had a message to call him because he wanted to replace the school librarian with a clerk.
And she had nominated him.
And she had nominated him for that award. That is a true story. So, anyway. That's, yes, talk about being sick to my stomach. But,
and I know the other side too, because my mother was a librarian for 38 years, and they replaced her with a clerk when she retired. So I know that side of it too, but it's different districts, so it goes back to that.
And it goes back to
the administration and what their buy-in is.
That's right.
Okay. I think we'll move on to the next step three. Suzy. Okay, step three is prioritize resources. So we're just going to do about a quick, we'll not discuss this one because we've kind of gone over it a little bit. But are there any comments on prioritizing resources?
What is the resource organizer?
Okay. Let me just say, this kind of came out of some discussion that the group was having about how, and this actually came from Barb, she said, the teachers come in and they say, I need everything that you have on penguins, or I need everything about apples. And so, to gather everything about apples with no idea about, well, what are your goals here? What's the intended outcome for the student? And so we developed this. We it's in draft phase now, but essentially it's a list of here's how you think about what you might need, and it's all dependent upon what learning goals there are. So for example, when you were throwing out all the different directions that you could go or all the different resources that you could bring in with Spider and the Fly, that might be fine. That's in the information gathering. But then to really sit down and think about which of these is really going to get at the heart of the learning goals from the beginning, those are the things that we need to focus on and that are really worthy of classroom time. A valuable classroom time, and which are just fine resources, but not for now.
And teachers need to come to us with a clear goal of what they want to accomplish. I mean, we can't read their minds.
You know? No, I think to her point up there, though, you can have some influence of that. I mean, you know a lot of stuff about all of the different kinds of directions that teachers could go, so you can have some influence, but you're right. There needs to be a clear sense of what those goals are.
Are you saying that tool is fully a checklist?
Right now, it has several different aspects to it. One has to do with the text complexity measures that we went through yesterday as a reminder, so that a teacher can kind of have a broad overview of all the resources and what levels those resources get to. So if the teacher looks at the collection of resources and sees that they're all very, very difficult or at the higher end of that,
Staircase.
At the higher end of that complexity, they might look for something a little easier so they can work on that spiraling and not have every single thing they throw at the kids be difficult. On the other hand, they might look at them and see that they're all easy and they need to throw in some extra things. They might also look at it and see that they're all text. Based and think, God, I need some videos or some, you know, something else other than just text. So it's more about, it's not really a checklist, it's more like a way to give them a broad view of every resource that's there and help them look at it holistically as far as what's the experience that the student's going to have. Well, that's something that we wondered about. What do you see as your role in that process, helping the educator to look at that?
Yeah. I had a powerful experience. It was both in autoclave classes, and since I've done this from preschool to high school, but we know like fourth grade, and it was the castle unit, and all the fourth graders know they get to do castles in fourth grade. And so the kids came in, and the teacher came in looking at that class that I was going to teach and said, we need castle things, you know, just like penguin things. And so I turned to the class and said, hey, let's see if we gather everything we can find, anything at all that might be on castles. And so they're like, can we look at the videos? Can we go online? And they gathered a plethora of materials. And when their teacher came back pretty much, they said, well, here's some things the kids thought might be helpful. And then one of the kids said, well, I don't know if this really pertains to what we're going to do, but it's kind of neat. And so I said, that's good. It may not answer a body question. And that has just become a philosophy. And it goes right in this Kansas and College for Standards. It's great if I know how to do it, but the question is, does my student in my classroom know how to do it? So just a food for thought that I happened upon. It wasn't smart enough to figure it out on my own. Thank you.
Okay, we're going to move right along to the purple part, the next part, plan student learning and activities. Plan student learning activities and assessments for progress.
So again, the question is, what do you see as your role as a school librarian in this piece of the process? Discuss for a bit, and then we'll have some quick responses.
go ahead and have a couple of quick comments. I have the first one right up here.
I was just saying that I think step four, where it says in the ways that these activities are going to be engaging students, I'm kind of in agreement with Julie up here that the students are actually finding the materials based on their own interests. There's always a couple experts in each of the topics that the teachers explore, and you just point to those experts, hey, in their private reading and their own private choices here in the library, Ms. Smith, you've got two experts in your class on this topic. And the kids just usually get real proud, and the teacher looks very surprised.
Well, and you as a librarian would know because you know what books they're checking out.
Any other comments on this one?
Well, I'm just gonna mention that one thing that we've been talking about that we need to bring in, because I'm gonna be presenting at Summer Academy, is formative assessments. So we did write, is that the right word? Okay. And so when I was doing mine, I was like, if I was gonna have them chart something on longitude and latitude, I would pick, I'd have them pick our town that we were living in, have everybody chart that, maybe have everybody chart some national force or something, and then let them go and do the charting themselves. So that's what we're talking about for the assessments. As you're going along with the activity, what can you do to make sure they're understanding what they need to do?
Yes, we really did want to build formative assessment into this process. What I see when I look at this is the experience that I had with my amazing library media specialist who would do research units with me. And I would just go to her and give her my assignment, and she was amazing. She would come and be with me in my classroom co-teaching for a week and sometimes 2 weeks. But we didn't really explicitly talk about what kinds of formative assessment we would have. How would we be certain that the kids knew how to do a valid search or knew how to get the things that they were after? Just a thought.
Okay, we're gonna move to the next one, but somehow it didn't get on the PowerPoint. So the very last one, culminating activity.
Plan culminating activity. So again, what do you see as being your role as a school librarian? Or I guess if we have some classroom teachers, what might you see as being the role of the school librarian in this piece of the process?
Well, the one thing that I think that I bring to the table for the teachers is that depending on the project, I can develop a rubric for them to use in the research process. I can also develop a rubric maybe rubric is the wrong word that I want to use, but like a process so that the students can see how close they're getting to the end of the project. And it's almost like a reflection guide so that they can see, oh wow, I have not done this part and I better go back here and do this. And the teachers don't necessarily always have the time to do that, but I can do something like that for them and I give it to them at the beginning of the project. Now again, that then brings in my informational management opportunities, and the teacher then can begin to see that I am vital to this activity process. So that's kind of something I do.
It kind of wraps back around to the very beginning where you tell them the purpose and you give them that question, the goal at the very beginning. So I see Myra creeping.
She's just a biter in the fly.
So we've come to the end of the game board. I know it's break time. Yay! I'm going to put our email addresses up on the screen, and then also the committee down here has been taking copious notes. So you can email us or give us more input. We value your input very much, and we're so glad that you're doing this for us. So thank you very much.